All right, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for the audience for attending this this panel on public pension funds, and to the panelists for agreeing to participate. My name is Luis Viceira, and I am the George E. Bates Professor of Finance at the Harvard Business School. And we have with us today a set of panelists who are, I think, very well recognized, both practitioners and academics, on pension fund investing and financing. So we had to, with us today, participating in the panel, Edwin Cass, who is the Senior Managing Director and Chief Investment Strategist at the Canada Pension Plan Investment Board, the CPP, as it's known in the profession. Next, sitting to Ed, we have Professor Joshua Rauh, who is the Ormond Family Professor of Finance at the Stanford Graduate School of Business, and is also a senior fellow at the Hoover Institution, also at Stanford University. Sitting next to Professor Rauh is Mrs. Theresa Whitmarsh, who is the Executive Director of the Washington State Investment Board. And finally, sitting next to me, we have Professor James Poterba, who is the Mitsui Professor of Economics at the MIT, and also the president of the National Bureau of Economic Research, NBER. So just to, you know, why holding a panel on public pension funds at the annual meetings of the American Finance Association and the American Economic Association? We have a system in the US of about 600 state and local public pension funds. They promise retirement security to about 15 million full-time employees and provide today retirement benefits to about another 10 million people, 10 million retirees. So these funds are hugely important in the fabric of retirement security in the US. They are also hugely important actors in capital markets. You know, today they have about $3.6 trillion in assets under management. So it's not an actor in capital markets that cannot be ignored. There is consensus, however, today that the system of state and local public pension funds is facing a very serious funding situation as a whole. There is cross-sectional variability, but as a whole, the system seems to be quite challenged on the funding side. Just to give you a sense, under newly implemented GASB public accounting standards, the pension shortfall today is calculated at about $1.2 trillion. And this figure can raise all the way to almost $5 trillion when we value the pension liabilities or the pension promises these funds make as another form of public debt. And so we discount those liabilities as we would discount any other public muni or state bond. So we are here today to hear from our panelists and hopefully gain a better understanding of what's the situation and, most importantly, also, what are the potential remedies to the situation, if any. So without delay, we're going to structure the panel by having our panelists to give us initial remarks, followed by a discussion on a set of questions, and hopefully we'll have time also to have a Q&A from the audience. So let's start, and I think we're going to start with Theresa. Please, you can give us your initial remarks on this topic. Thank you so much. You have 15 minutes.
I've set in my timer.
Good, thank you.
Thank you so much, Luis. First of all, it's a privilege to be here. Public pensions are my passion. I don't think there's any greater privilege in public service than taking care of the retirement needs of people who work very, very hard every day to take care of the least advantaged in our society. And so I'm delighted that there's actual interest in this topic from this many people. Let's see here if I can get to my, we've got a couple extra things open here on the screen. There we go. So, as Luis mentioned, the state of the U.S. public pension industry is really, really dire. And you're going to hear a lot more about that and with more detail, I think, from Josh and some of our other panelists. But it is a really difficult situation we face. Washington, thank goodness, is an exception to the rule, though we're not without our own challenges. But bottom line, we're one of the better funded states in the nation, better funded systems, and it's for a lot of reasons that I'll go over. The first, I think that basically it's very simple to create a really good pension system in theory. You have to have sound benefit design. You have to have adequate contributions that match the benefit promises that you've made. And then you've got to have a sophisticated, good investment program. Fortunately, Washington basically has all three functioning quite well. In terms of sound benefit design, Washington was a real leader in getting rid of what I call gold-plated benefits. If you see here, we made our first reforms back in 1977. These are reforms that are just now being made by other states. We closed what was called Plan One. Plan One was essentially you work 30 years and you got 80% of your average two-year highest salary. It was very, very rich benefits. So a lot of people come right out of high school, go to work for the state or the county, 18 years old. They could retire at 48 and live off retirement for another 35 years. And there was an automatic COLA of 3% per year, no matter what was going on in terms of inflation. Very, very rich and unaffordable benefit. So that was closed, and again, we had a forward-thinking legislature at the time. That was closed, created Plan 2 with an age 65 normal retirement age. Anything below that is actuarially reduced. And employees and the employer equally share in contributions. So there's actually stakeholders on both sides are aligned in terms of funding the plan. We were also a very early adopter of what's called a risk-sharing hybrid design, half-defined benefit, half-defined contribution. Both the pure defined benefit and the hybrid plan are open to new members, but many of the younger workforce like the hybrid plan because their defined contribution portion of that is portable and they can take that to another employer. So we have a number of years' experience with that plan. And again, it was designed to share risk equally between the employee and the employer. We were also the first state to create a really sophisticated risk assessment of plan sustainability, and it was our state actuary who actually designed it in kind of the go-go years of mid-2000 when we were making double-digit returns. Legislature, as you'll see later, got very generous with benefits, did not actively contribute. And so we had an actuary who stepped up and said, I have got to put together a model that the legislature and policymakers can understand that shows exactly what the implications are to funded status of these various things that people were interested in doing in terms of benefit enhancements. So basically we have good benefit design. Now in terms of contributions, I always call it mostly adequate contributions. You can see through the 90s, the legislature contributed 100% or nearly 100% in every year of the actuarial recommended contribution. But then you see that dip in early 2000s, and some of our legislative staff call that the Happy Valley. When I say it, what were they smoking? Of course, Washington was the first state to legalize marijuana, but not back then. So basically, we were making double-digit returns, 20%, 22%, and the legislature thought, the investment board is making such good returns, we don't have to contribute the actuarial assumed contribution. So they took a break or took a holiday from contributions. Then, you know, the actuary presented all his data. They, in 08, 09, started getting more serious about funding. And then, of course, the financial crisis hit and they couldn't afford to fund. So the irony here for policymakers is when the state was in an economic boom, investment returns were great, it would have been the easiest time to set aside contributions is when they contributed the least. And you see this behavior all over the country. So bottom line, future contribution increases are expected, and I won't go into this whole slide, but there is a significant effort underway to get us back to full contributions over time. And then the final leg of the stool is a good investment program. One thing that our state did that's unique is in 1981, they created the State Investment Board, and they took all of the small, local, county, city, teachers, firefighters, law enforcement, all those various systems, and they put it in one single system with one organization to run the assets so that they would get professional asset management. And that was when they created the State Investment Board. And overall, we've had really good returns by having a professionally managed program. The very top row shows the total commingled trust fund returns on a 1, 3, 5, 10, and 20-year time frame. And all except 10-year, we have exceeded the actuarial assumed rate of return. But what I really want to point out on this is you look at the public asset returns versus our private asset returns. In Washington, I'll go into this a little more, but we have a real strong history of investing in private equity and real estate and alternatives. And as you can see, those have been our best performing asset classes over time. And so because we're heavily weighted, you actually see our current asset allocation in the pie chart below. We have close to 40% of our assets in alternatives in private assets, and those have been our best performing asset classes in this time period. So that is partly what has allowed us to be a leader. We have a long history in both asset classes. One of the things that you'll hear a lot about discussed in the pension community today is, are funds who are underfunded reaching too far out on the risk spectrum for yield? And it's an absolutely appropriate and fair question. We were fortunate in that we got to the party early. We started investing in private equity in 1981 and in real estate in 1982. So we have very mature programs. We have a lot of experience. We made a lot of mistakes that probably some funds are just now beginning to make. And so we have a program that has performed very, very well. We also were very early to globally diversify. We started about 10, 12 years ago to put a big push in emerging markets. This is our current allocation. It's interesting, primarily just because of asset values. We were about 52% North America just 2 or 3 years ago. But because valuations have increased significantly in North America, we're up to 60%. Europe was about 20%. It's down 17%. And our Latin America and Asia exposures were actually higher. But again, just because of the kind of route in emerging markets, valuations have decreased in those. But again, we were very early to go global, and that's also helped us. I want to talk a little bit about risk because it's one thing that's in the news a lot about public pension systems is, are they taking on too much risk? The way we think about risk is there's not a single asset class that is too risky. There are risk ranges within every asset class. And ultimately, when you're constructing a total portfolio, you have to think about the risk spectrum of each asset class. And we'll just look at private equity. There's a big difference in volatility in, say, venture versus mega buyout. And we're biased closer to the lower risk strategies in there. Even public equity, you look at emerging markets versus domestic markets. Fixed income, treasuries versus corporates versus emerging market sovereign debt. So when we think about risk, we're very granular in our approach. And as we're building our portfolios, we build them from the bottom up thinking about that. I also want to make a quick comment on volatility because that is the thing that is most often referred to when you think about risk, but I actually think it's the least important measure. It's hugely important when you're building your capital market assumptions because obviously your compounded or geometric return assumption is based on volatility or has volatility as a component to it. So it's a great modeling tool, but in fact, it's not what I spend my days thinking about. The kinds of risks that I spend my days thinking about are operational risk. As we're owning private assets, you think about who's running that company, who's running that mine for you, what ecological disaster are we going to be, it's going to ruin our reputation. You think about the partners you pick. Are they going to be disciplined through multiple market cycles? There's so many other risks that keep a public pension fund investor up at night. Volatility gets the most headlines, but it's really the least important to us. It also is not important because we're a long horizon investor. And so while mark-to-market values change, when so much of our focus is on current income that's generated from our portfolio, as long as that portfolio is continuing to produce income and we're not forced to sell, we never actually take that actual loss. And that's particularly important in private assets. I also want to just make a quick comment on private equity. Again, because we have a mature program, we have a lot of data going way back. And overall, it has very consistently performed for us over time. So there's no single vintage year where we've actually lost money because our portfolio is so well diversified across strategies, countries, managers, et cetera. But there's also no big home run vintage years that have skewed results. It's just actually, for all the press about it being a highly volatile asset class, it's been a pretty consistent performer for us. Real estate, we set up a very interesting program where we essentially decided we don't like funds, real estate is a long-term hold, and we can handle illiquidity in our fund. And so we actually find operators, real estate operators who we like, we put them in business just for us, and where we own 98%, management owns 2%, and they only invest on our behalf. The reason they strike that deal with us is because they get evergreen capital, they never worry about fundraising again, and we get a dedicated team where we have terrific governance rights and we have alignment of interest. So again, there's lots of ways to implement an alternative asset class that mitigates some of the risk inherent in those asset classes. I'm going to talk a little bit about current market conditions and what we see going forward. And essentially, there's sort of three themes that I'll go through. And one, I'll just talk about diversification. You know, the whole history and the free lunch in investing was being broadly diversified. Well, we did all of that. But today, diversification is not nearly enough. We also are finding that, and basically because we're in what we call this divergence era, where developed economies are not moving in lockstep. Emerging markets are not moving in lockstep. Central banks are not moving in lockstep. We are seeing incredible divergence across all economies. And it's really forcing us to be, once again, much more granular and bottom-up in our investment approach. So what's a public plan to do based on this very challenging, more low-return market environment? One of the things that I kind of came up when I was thinking about this a year ago is discrimination is not always a dirty word. We went from diversification to having to be so much more discriminating in our investments. And that means that basically we have to test for quality, opportunity, and value in every single asset or manager that we look at. Things right now are really frothy. Markets are highly overvalued in many places, and it's tough to figure out where to put money to work. So that requires an incredible level of discipline. And once again, in the past, you could just diversify across asset classes, strategies. That's no longer the case. There's a lot of things that are overpriced. We also have to think about risk in a very holistic way, and I've touched on that, but we have to think about risk as ultimate loss of capital, and we have to think so much more about long-term, long-horizon investing. So I'm saying essentially we have to condition for the marathon, not the sprint. I think another thing is we always think about reversion to the mean, and we believe in reversion to the mean, but what new mean are we reverting to? We have to be really realistic about what we can earn going forward and have honest conversations with our lawmakers and policymakers and our boards about that. A couple concluding thoughts. Just in terms of observations I made, I actually created this slide so I could share it with the legislature, and it was to bring home the point that don't put too much pressure on me as an investor to solve your benefit design and contribution shortfall challenges. Investing can only do so much. And so what I showed, and you know, this took a little bit of guts to present this to the Select Committee on Pension Policy. But what I did is I took and looked at our annualized returns over the last couple decades, and I looked at the net present value of the liability increases based on their benefit enhancements. And there's a really interesting correlation here. So that you see when we made, okay, and this is, I'm to my next to last slide. when we make really good returns over multiple years, and you can see the bar chart here in 2000, after we've made great returns, policymakers get generous and make big benefit increases. And then guess what? Immediately, that's right at the time that the market turns. All of that advantage that we gain, we lose. They're really disciplined for quite a few years after that. Markets, and you know, we do really well, you know, make double-digit returns, and guess what? They provide a whole lot more benefit enhancements, and then, boom, markets crash. So I think this was actually very enlightening for the legislature to look at, but you know, the thing that it makes me really wonder, is there any such thing as a human being who's fit for purpose when it comes to pension management? you know, behavioral economics will tell you that for the most part, we are really flawed decision makers, and you really see that in the history of pensions in Washington State. So kind of conclusion, lessons for policymakers, you know, it's very straightforward in theory, but messy in practice. Fully cost out your benefits, ensure adequate contributions, and invest for the long term. And challenges, and you'll hear more about this from Josh, but the real challenges are governance and fully understanding risk in the system. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Theresa. So Josh.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here with this esteemed panel talking about public pension funds. And I want to focus my remarks today on the topic of governance. So when it comes to public pension funds, there are two relevant areas of governance that are somewhat separate. And I want to talk about those individually. The first one is what I call budgetary governance, which is the question of pension funding and broad asset allocation. This is the general question of how are benefits determined, described, and how are they going to be measured and planned for through a discount rate and expected return on assets. This type of budgetary governance has direct effects on government budgets through the determination of contributions. The second area of governance is an area that I think Theresa focused on a great deal in her talk, which is what I would describe as investment governance, and not only this question of broad asset allocation, but also manager selection, and the idea that it's important for a pension fund to select investments that satisfy fiduciary requirements, and that also has indirect effects on government budgets through the efficiency of investments, because as the public would like the pension system to be providing the benefits that they're promising to public employees in as efficient a way as possible. So I'm going to talk about each of these areas. So first of all, by budgetary governance, let me give a very simple example of what I mean. Suppose we have a state, okay, and the very simple model of a state where the residents are paying income taxes. That's the money in this bag here. The money is being directed to the central government, okay, of the state, and then that money is being deployed on various public services that citizens enjoy. So if we just have a sort of static model like this, or if you think of this as what's happening every year, then this appears to be a model of a balanced budget, because the money that is being collected from taxpayers is being spent on services in the current year. The question when we get into pensions is, you know, what happens if each of these public employees here is also expecting a pension when they retire? So I put some numbers on here that are numbers related to some things that you might see cited in the popular press. So $19,000 per year is what the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees says that their members, they're the largest public sector union, public sector worker union, that their members receive as an average pension when they retire. That includes partial career workers, some part-time workers as well, so it's just averaged over anybody who receives a government pension from state or local governments. Maybe this teacher here is expecting around $45,000 per year. That's what the New York City Teachers Union says that their teachers receive on average, again, averaged over different careers, career lengths. This public safety official may be expecting $82,300 per year when he retires. That's what an average retiree of the California Highway Patrol in 2013 got in the first year of retirement, again, averaged over career lengths. And you also often read about people who are receiving fairly hefty pensions, so $100,000 is often a point where you hear discussions. So over 20,000 members of CalPERS receive a pension of over $100,000 per year, and that costs the state around $2.75 billion. So the question is obviously, you know, from the perspective of governance, what does the state need to do in the present year in order to be able to assert that they are following good budgetary governance, or maybe to define it more precisely, running a balanced budget? Because 49 of the 50 states of the U.S. have balanced budget requirements. And so the question is, what are they doing in order to be able to claim that they're running a balanced budget? Obviously, if they weren't setting any money aside, they would not, under any definition, be running a balanced budget. So what's important is that they're setting aside, in some sense, an amount that's going to be sufficient to justify the claim that they're running balanced budgets. So rules are important. Here's an example of, obviously, following some kind of rule is important. Here's an example of a city where we happen to be located that is that has set some rules but not followed them. So if you set rules for running a balanced budget and you don't follow them, then that's a clear example of, you know, kind of not good budgetary governance. So here's the city of Chicago, and what I've done is I've added up their four major pension funds: police, fire, municipal, and laborers. And what you can see with the blue line is the blue line are their actual contributions as a share of the city government revenue. And the red line is what are called actuarially determined contributions, which are the contributions that actuaries have calculated that the city should be making. And for many years, and actually for many years going before this graph, there was a divergence between these two lines, where actuaries were in total saying that the city should be contributing amounts that exceeded around 20% of the budget, but the city was only contributing around 10% of the budget, because the city's rules for contributing were not explicitly linked to what the actuaries said should be contributed. These lines diverged more over time, and then during the financial crisis, they diverged even more because the city lost money in its investments. We've recently had a large property tax in the city of Chicago that has gone pretty much solely to trying to fund these pensions. That's where you see the jump up of 10% to 20% of the budget going towards pensions. But of course, if you ask the actuaries would say that around 38% of the budget should be being contributed to these pension systems. And we haven't talked about the teachers of the school system. This is just these four. So this is an example of clearly flawed budgetary governance, or put another way, it would be hard with a straight face for the city to claim that they're running a balanced budget when they're not even doing what the actuaries say they need to be doing to plan for pensions. But let's look at what the actuarial standards themselves are. So it's clearly not sufficient for good budgetary governance if you're not following actuarial standards. But is it sufficient if you are following actuarial standards? And what do the actuarial standards say? The actuarial standards say that city and state governments should discount their liabilities at an expected return on pension plan assets with an asterisk here related to GASB 6768, which are the new standards, which has a sort of unless your actuaries say your assets are going to run out, in which case you're supposed to discount the liabilities covered by the assets at the expected return and those not covered by the assets at a high-grade municipal rate. So in practice, what does this mean? In practice, systems are using an expected rate of return of around 7.6% per year to budget for their pension promises. So that means that they're assuming that every dollar that goes into their pension system is going to double roughly every 10 years. And GASB 67 required some of them to apply a little bit more discipline in these rates, although very few systems actually admitted or believed that their assets were ever going to run out, because one is allowed a fair amount of discretion in assuming future contributions. And so if you can assume future contributions as well as future investment returns, it doesn't often appear that assets are going to expire. So GASB 67 required them to lower the rate on an average over all the systems in the universe by around 0.2 percentage points, and affected around 11% of systems out there, according to my most recent survey of these. So what do systems do in order to target these expected returns? Well, there's been a lot of talk about this. This is the public fund asset allocation for 2015. And what you can see is that on average, public pension funds invest 52% in publicly traded equities, 16% in alternatives, notably private equity and hedge funds, 6% in real estate, 2% in other, and 24% in bonds or cash. So despite having very bond-like liabilities, which are defined by benefit formulas, public funds are approaching this problem by saying, we're going to invest in an amount that's considerably less than the present value of these benefits, if you value them as being a government promise. We're going to invest considerably less, but we're going to invest in these asset classes, which historically would have generated, you know, over the last 20 or 30 years, would have generated a return of around 7.5% or maybe even more, and that we're going to plan and fund for benefits that way. This creates a setting where there is a tremendous amount of a very politicized environment surrounding the setting of these targeted rates of return. So there's been a lot of discussion lately in an environment of much lower yields on safer securities of lowering discount rates. So CalPERS, the largest system in the U.S., in 2016, the board voted to reduce the rate from 7.5% to 7% over the coming 3 years. And a lot of cities are complaining that this is going to lead to a sharp increase in their quote-unquote costs. I put costs in quotes because the cost, in a political sense, is how much cities or states are under their own rules contributing to these pension systems. The cost, in an economic sense, is what is the present value of new accruals and the present value of contributions to pay off legacy liabilities, which are government debt. Another good example is here in Illinois, the teachers' retirement system voted to reduce their rate from 8% to 7.5% in 2014 at a cost of around $500 million per year. That meant that $500 million additional dollars of a budget of around $37 billion had to go just to this one of five Illinois pension plans. This happened again in 2016, where they voted again to reduce the rate, and it was criticized by the governor. And I think it, you know, this is the political view of the pension fund. This is a bathtub. And, you know, the governor sees the drain is open and money is flowing out to pay pensions. And the discount rate speeds up the rate of water that's flowing into the bathtub from taxpayer dollars. And so this setup creates a system where there is a political view of the pension fund that does not necessarily want to accept the idea of lower rates, that prefers instead to budget based on these expected returns. Big news this year in pensions was that there was a task force of actuaries that put out a paper that they were initially contracted to put out, but then the society decided they weren't so keen on the paper. The paper outlined three definitions of the pension liability at different discount rates. One is the budgetary liability, which is what they do now. Take an expected rate of return on pension assets, measure your liability that way. The second is a market liability, where the timing and the probability of the payment of promised benefits is taken into account. So there are states such as, there are states such as Indiana, where the constitution of the state says the pension benefits are a gratuity springing from the generosity of the state. And there are states such as Illinois, where the constitution says these pensions will be paid no matter what. And so a market liability might account for the fact that in certain states, if they were very underfunded and pension rights were weak, the taxpayers might not have to come up with all of the cash. And then finally, there's what's called the solvency liability, which is what is used in Europe, you know, the Netherlands and Denmark and other countries to measure the value of the liability. And it really matters what standard you use. So GASB 67 are budgetary standards. Under those standards, there is an unfunded liability under U.S. funds of around $1.2 trillion. Under solvency standards, it ends up being around $3.4 trillion. So concluding thoughts on budgetary governance before I say something about investment governance for just a couple minutes. So under an economic definition, there is no state or local government that sponsors a defined benefit plan that runs a balanced budget, even if it's following the actuarially required contribution, because the taxpayers are still underwriting and guaranteeing the states of the world where the assets do not perform to the tune of these 7.5% targeted returns. If you use standard finance models, the odds of achieving a targeted return are around 25%. And I think this raises really interesting budgetary governance questions, which is really, you know, should the government budget be viewed as balanced under those probabilities? What probability would be adequate? Should governments view their budgets as balanced under a 50% probability? Even there, you ask, what about state pricing? The states of the world where pension fund assets don't pay off what they've been expected to or hope to pay off, those are states of the world where presumably private sector individuals are also down in their own investments and in their own prospects, and you would think that maybe the government should be particularly robust in those states of the world to be able to help them out, whereas right now they're doing a kind of reverse reverse risk management of these of this state pricing and these problems. So that's quite separate from investment governance. I know I'm roughly fairly out of time, but I want to say something briefly about this, where, you know, the Theresa's task is to assemble efficient portfolios to target the expected return. And here, you know, we see heterogeneity in board composition and heterogeneity in performance. And it's particularly important in the areas of private equity, real estate, and other alternatives, because there are large spreads in performance of the better versus the worst funds. These are opaque asset classes that are difficult for the public to monitor. And there is a scope to interpret the public interest. So in some recent work with Yael Hochberg and Alex Andenoff, who are here in the audience, we looked at pension fund board composition and found that there's a range of categories and a range of ways that pension funds are put together. Public appointees, members of the pension plan themselves, rank and file members, and state politicians being the main categories. And we found a lot of heterogeneity in political representation. So this is the Minnesota State Board. This is comprised pretty much solely of ex officio members of the state government. Here is the Washington State Investment Board, which has a lot of appointed members of the participants on the board, which is actually a structure which we find to be quite quite positive for returns. And other funds have got various mixes of elected members of the participant rank and file, independent directors, so members of the public generally appointed, and ex officio or politicians. What do we find? We find that despite their relevant experience, each additional 10 percentage points of the board who are government officials reduces performance by fairly substantial amounts, by around one net IRR percentage point if the official is appointed by another government official, by around half a net IRR point if the official sits on the board by virtue of the office. And also, if you have elected members of the pension plan, the rank and file, they don't tend to do very well because the members of the general public or of the members of the rank and file members of the plan don't tend to elect the members that necessarily have the most experience. So I actually had a slide in there about that, but I'm out of time, so I'll just go to the conclusions, which is that, you know, budgetary governance for public pension funds completely ignores risk, and U.S. funds generally reject the idea of liability-driven investing on the grounds that you don't really get an equity risk premium for doing that, but the trouble is that taxpayers are underwriting insurance on that risk premium and on the entire system. And so if you leave those taxpayers out of the picture, you can understand why funds like the idea of, you know, banking on this equity risk premium, because someone else is picking up the downside. So budgetary governance, I think a lot of open questions as to whether we're doing things correctly. Investment governance for public pension funds depends on the board and other structures, and I think research has a lot of potential to shed light on beneficial practices in those areas. So thank you for allowing me to go over by 2 minutes, Luis, and very pleasure to be on this panel.
Thank you, George. I was called outside. But it's pretty cold inside now after your presentation. So, but it's always good to, as you mentioned, to hear what's being done in other geographies, in other pension systems, and I'm very pleased that Ed Cass decided to join us for this panel and give us a view of what's being done in our neighbors
Somebody
north of us in Canada.
Great. Thank you very much. As Luis said, Ed Cass, I work at the Canada Pension Plan Investment Board. I think you thought it would be interesting to relay a couple anecdotes from the Canadian experience, and one is the fact that we've had some of the same challenges that you've had here in the U.S. I think it's Canada's, I guess, fortune to have kind of had those challenges rear up almost 20 years in advance of what you're experiencing here. I think a lot of the time Canada gets a lot of credit for having this great system and anticipating a lot of the difficulties. My personal view, the kind of humble Canadian view, is we frequently run into the problems way in advance of others. So by the time the problem hits other communities, it's almost like we've already experienced it and hopefully tried to fix it. We've tried to fix our pension problem. I wouldn't say we got it perfect, but I think we've made some great strides, and I'll go through that. The second is asset management. A lot of the Canadian pension funds have been held out as having a unique model, the so-called Canadian investment model, the Canadian pension plan investment model, in kind of a broad Canadian sense. And I'll talk a bit about how we manage money and why perhaps it's slightly different than what other pension funds globally do. First, by way of background, the Canadian system is more or less a traditional one. There's various pillars in terms of pension retirement kind of schemes or plans. There's individual savings, and right now that's both private savings as well as kind of a tax-incented system that's similar to your 401k system. There's registered pension plans. Those are private plans that are typically employer-sponsored. And most people, I shouldn't say most people in Canada, roughly half the people in Canada participate in one of those plans. And then there's two schemes that are run by the government. One is a kind of universal plan. It's old age security, so no matter whether you've ever worked in the past, whether or not you've ever contributed to a plan directly, you're entitled to old age security payments. And then there's the Canada Pension Plan, which is the plan whose assets that our organization manages, and that's formed by contributions from employees and employers throughout their working life in Canada. And you can think of those four pillars right now as providing roughly equal contributions to someone's retirement income once they've retired. Now, the Canada Pension Plan itself was originally set up in 1966. So there was a Prime Minister in Canada that was foresighted enough at the time, Pearson, to put in place a scheme to help augment the retirement income of people in Canada once they retired. At the time they put in the plan, the demographics were very favorable. So the dependency ratio in terms of the number of people that were working in the workforce as opposed to the number of people who retired was roughly 6-1. So there's tremendous leverage in the system in the sense of being able to collect contributions and paying out benefits. You had 6 times as many people putting in money as taking out money. And when they first set up the plan and the contribution rates and the benefits, they kind of projected that as a steady state condition. Now, of course, in most of the developed world, that didn't persist. So you had radical changes in the dependency ratio. And by the mid-1990s in Canada, we could easily see that dependency ratio had already changed, had gone from around 6-1 to 4-1, and if we looked out, say, another 25 to 30 years, we saw that moving down to roughly 2-1. That meant, of course, that the contribution rate that was currently in place, there's no way that could sustain the benefits payments. Of course, there was other factors going on as well. You had increased life expectancy, so between 1966 and around 1995, again, when we started taking a look at our problems, you had a roughly 10-year increase in life expectancy, which just is, for a pension fund, that's close to a death condition in terms of sustainability. Most people focus on mortality in terms of the liability side of a pension fund's balance sheet, but there's a whole bunch of other factors, and a big one in Canada was immigration rates. So traditionally, we had quite a large immigration contribution to the workforce that had steadily been decreasing as between 1966 and 1995. So all three of those factors were pointing in the same direction. I often say you should never waste a good crisis, and I kind of alluded to 1995 a couple times because that's really when we really had to face this problem. There was a number of things. There were the factors that I just mentioned in terms of demographics changing, in terms of mortality changing, in terms of immigration policy changes. But there was also a terrible government fiscal situation in Canada in the mid-1990s. So in 1995, Canada actually got put on credit watch by the major rating agencies. The federal debt was roughly 65% of GDP, and if you totaled the provincial debt, Canada, a kind of federated state, you could get up north of 100%. It was almost 100% debt to GDP, so we got put on credit watch. It was also time of a lot of financial instability. We'd just come out of the late 80s where there was very high unemployment. U.S. was starting to take off, go into those go-go years that Theresa referred to, but still in Canada, our industry was lagging and the financial situation was not in good shape. So people looked around and saw all these problems and can we fix them? And there was a very influential politician at the time named Paul Martin who tackled actually both these problems, tackled the government deficits, also tackled the pension plan problem. I just mentioned that Canada's a federated state. So there's 10 provinces, there's a financial government. Pensions actually come under the purview of the provinces. So in the Constitution, they kind of allocate responsibilities between the federal government and the provinces. Pensions come under the provinces, but the federal government also had the scheme that I just said, the Canada Pension Plan was put in place back in 1966. So you had this problem of trying to reconcile the interests of the provinces and the interests of the federal government, and I like to say that neither one of those groups actually trusted each other very much. So you had, at the face of it, what would be a real issue, but I think it developed into a healthy kind of tension where the provinces had to work with the federal government to arrive at a scheme that both of them viewed as sustainable and both of whom viewed it kind of comfortably. The way they sought it off is, I would say, two big things. One is a change to the contribution benefit kind of system levels, and the second is a new entity, which is our organization to manage the funds. On the contributions and benefits side, they made a very difficult decision. So they decided that the benefits that existed at the time would be maintained. Now, on the slide I say that there's reduced benefits, but the reduced benefits were very, very marginal in terms of changes to the sustainability of the plan. And they decided to pay for that kind of maintenance of that benefit promise, contributions would have to increase. Now, at the time they originally put the plan in place, contributions were 3.6%, 1.8% paid by employees, 1.8% paid by employers. That 3.6 in 1997, when the changes were made, went all the way up to 10%. So a huge increase in the contribution rate. If you think about it, and they thought about it a lot at the time, that is just an intergenerational transfer. So you're saying we're going to keep the people whole in terms of their benefit entitlements in the past, we're going to make the future pay for it. And talking earlier with Theresa, you know, that was kind of repugnant to them. It was something that was a very difficult decision. They made it consciously, they made it explicitly, so there's transparency in the fact that that's what they're going to do. But it was not something that they enjoyed doing, it was not something they took lightly. As a result of that, they made certain, or they incorporated certain provisions into the legislation when they made the changes, and one of them was that if there was to be any future increase in entitlements, those would have to be fully funded. And right now we're going through a situation in Canada where we've decided to increase the benefits under the Canada Pension Plan. We've said people aren't saving enough. So we're making amendments to the plan to increase the benefit payments. That's resulted in increased contribution payments. But all those benefits that we're going to be increasing have to be fully funded. So now when we're looking at our plan, we're actually looking at managing two plans, one of which is a partially funded plan and one of which is a fully funded plan. The other thing that arose, the big change, was the imposition of an asset manager in place of a federal or provincial government holding the asset. So again, I mentioned the provinces and the federal government didn't really trust each other. Provinces said, fine, you can increase the contribution rate all the way up to 10%, but we don't want to see that money sitting on the federal government's balance sheet because we think you'll spend it. Provinces between themselves were uncomfortable putting it down at the provincial level because they thought, well, Ontario at the time was the biggest province in terms of manufacturing activity, in terms of actual income, GDP. Said, well, you'll take most of that money, you'll dedicate it to projects within the province. So how do we solve this problem? We're actually going to segregate the funds. So the federal government collects those funds at source. Once they've collected them at source, they take them, they segregate them from the rest of the federal government's balance sheet. In essence, transfer them to our corporation to manage from an investment perspective. One of the keys, we think, to our success as an organization has been a very clear independent mandate. So we think our governance is a real strength of our organization. And we are a creature of statute, so everything that goes into how we operate as a fund is kind of written into statute. It's a piece of law. That piece of law has been adopted by other jurisdictions. So if you go to New Zealand, say, you can take a look at New Zealand's pension plan. It's a virtual copy of the Canadian pension plan in terms of how it's set up. We think the reason they copied us is because it's a good system and it's worked. There's three main levels of governance that we think are important. One is an investment-only mandate. So when that money gets transferred to us, we're mandated to manage it to maximize return subject to undue risk of loss, having regard to the factors that affect the funding of the plan. But nowhere in there does it say anything about doing anything for a social purpose or a government purpose or a provincial purpose. And in fact, if a member of government comes to us and asks us to do a project in their province or support a project in the province, we're actually supposed to report them to the federal authorities. So it's a crime for someone in government to come to us and try and get leverage on us to invest in something that they're vested in. Independent fund, I already mentioned that monies get transferred to us, they're segregated. There's no way for the government to come back and get those monies. So it really is a system where the people that are contributing to the system own the system and are the ultimate people responsible for it. So they get the benefits. Also, if there's experience shortfalls, they have to pay the cost. Last, there's guaranteed long-term stability in terms of the setup of the plan. So it's fine to say you've incorporated all these things into a piece of legislation, but what if the legislation changes? Sometimes that's fairly easy to do. In Canada, again, as I said, as there's a tension there between the provinces and the federal government, both of them had to kind of buy into this plan. And one of the fail-safe mechanisms that they agreed on as a result of that healthy tension, again, was that the legislation could only be changed if two-thirds of the provinces voted to change it, along with two-thirds of the population and the federal government. So just to put that in context, that's a higher standard to change our governing legislation than it is to change the Constitution of Canada. You only need half the provinces in Canada to vote, representing half the population, to change the Constitution, whereas our act is higher than that. Talk really quickly about our investment activities and that kind of Canadian model. I think the best way to think about that is just the evolution of our investment activities from the very beginning when we first received our first dollar from Ottawa, which was back in 1997 till now. We inherited a partial reserve fund at that time that was 100% fixed income instruments and 100% Canadian obligations, whether it's obligations of the provinces or obligations of the federal government. The first thing that we started to do was diversify that into some equities. If you take a look at the contribution rate and the ultimate benefits payable, it was the only way that system works is if we expose the reserve fund to the capital markets. So the underlying assumptions of the chief actuary at the time kind of gauges the kind of the budgetary governance. Let's say in Josh's terms around the sustainability of the plan would be invested roughly 65% in equities, 35% debt. We kind of started moving towards that. Originally, we did that through a outsourced model, so we were kind of a virtual pension fund. We only had seven people. But within the first 5 years, we tried to transition that from an outside model to one where we brought all the investment capabilities in-house. So around 2003, 2004, we started setting up capital markets teams internally to invest in equities, to invest in debt directly. And that was kind of our first big shift. In 2005, we kind of went the next step and we said, look, as an organization, we have certain comparative advantages and we identified three, and one was scale, the size of the fund. The size of the fund could be predicted with a pretty high degree of accuracy in terms of growth of size over time. And we said, look, roughly by 2045, we're going to be $1 trillion in assets, so we have tremendous scale behind us. That should allow us to do some things other people can't do. We have a very long-term investment horizon, so again, when the chief actuary measures sustainability, he's looking out 75 years. And the third is we have certainty of assets, so we know the money's coming in. Unlike, say, a hedge fund who has a quarterly redemption, we know we're going to get money in year after year after year. So we made the decision to do what we call active management, which is diversifying out of public markets into private markets such as infrastructure, real estate, credit. That has certain corollaries, and just to sum up here, those corollaries are the things that have led to the definition of the Canadian model, and one of those is global presence. So if we're going to invest in real estate, we're going to invest in infrastructure, we're going to do that at scale. We don't think that we can do that unless we're on the ground in the locations in which we're investing. So we now have offices in London, Hong Kong, Mumbai, Sao Paulo, New York. We're globally represented now with investors to try and access those opportunities. And the second, and I think this is the one that's most often pointed to, especially by my American colleagues, is the fact that we place a huge emphasis on talent and hiring the right individuals. And that means that we adopt a more competitive pay schedule in terms of paying our investment professionals, I wouldn't say equally to what investment professionals get paid at private investment organizations, but competitively towards that. And we think that's one of the things that allows us to achieve our success.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Ed.
All right. Well, thank you for including me in this panel. There are a host of really interesting economic questions and financial economic questions to think about with regard to public pensions. And I'm going to pivot off some of the earlier comments, particularly Josh's on governance this morning, and try to talk a little bit about the accountability mechanisms that operate for trying to restore or push toward funding adequacy within the public sector in the United States. And you've heard terrific presentations from Theresa and from Ed about various institutional structures that can be used to try to build both adequate investment management as well as the custody of the assets here in place. Josh talked a bit about what the governance structure is. If you were parachuting into the United States to look at public sector pension plans, I think the immediate things you would observe are, first, that the distribution of funding leaves you with significant gaps. And I'm not going to touch the question of what's the right way to measure them. These are measured not making the Rauh Novi Marks adjustments to do what I'll call the financial economics, riskless discount rate calculation. But these are sort of closer to reported values. These are from Alicia Minnell and J.P. Aubrey at the Boston College Center for Retirement Research. Right. But in 2015, you see that sort of being in the 60 to 80% window is where most of the plans tend to fall at this point. And we'd also see that the pattern over time has been a sharp increase in the required level of contributions to these plans on the part of the state and local government sector. At the same time, there has been relatively limited progress in terms of filling the hole that's there. So the fraction of contributions that have been made relative to what would be deemed necessary under the existing rules has averaged something between 80 and 90% over most of this period, but we're not seeing that ticking up despite the fact that we've seen this growing need for amounts to fund. Right? And I think the picture of the bathtub kind of is very good at capturing the essence of what's going on here, right? And the last 15 years have been a time when, in some sense, the perfect storm for defined benefits plans has played out. In some, it's like the drain got cleaned so that the outflow was expanded, right? Because the combination of declining long-term real interest rates, along with greater longevity, right, and for a period declining equity markets in particularly the public equity market space, contributed to increasing liabilities at a time when the asset base was in many cases contracting, leading you with this growing gap that needed to be dealt with. And that's, of course, what you see in terms of that rising need for contributions over time. All right, so taking that as our starting point, the question I'd like to ask is, what are the forces that discipline underfunding, and how do they contrast in the public sector and the private sector? What are the differences in the way DB plans have worked out in the public and the private sector in the US, and then what can we turn to try to understand what's happening there? So ultimately, this comes down to a question of who's the residual claimant, right? Who's left holding the bag? Again, I'm pivoting off, Josh had the bag, but somebody in the sector, somebody has to get left holding the bag when we've got these liabilities which are not going to be met by the assets that have been sort of collected for them, and the question is who that's going to be. So in the private sector, I think it's relatively straightforward, right? In the private sector, it's ultimately the equity holders in the firm. It's not quite that simple, but in a firm that was not going to go bankrupt, right, the way we would think about this is to say, When the firm promises unfunded liabilities in the DB plan, that's ultimately something which has to be funded in the future. So the equity holders today's equity holders need to recognize that that's a liability they've taken on, right? And consequently, at least in the simplest models, we'd have a very easy way to understand what's happened. Corporate equity values, share prices for the firm today would decline. That's the way we think about the transfer, right? The managers vote this in. If they don't fund it, we basically see a hit to the equity holders today. Benefit for the future retirees, loss to the current shareholders. There is no complicated intergenerational analysis to be performed. It's not a question in the simplest story of whether today's shareholders are going to be benefited or lose relative to the future shareholders, because we think in the corporate sector that at least our starting point would be rational expectations, present discounted value of these liabilities is worked out. Right. Now, I know, and there are many experts in the audience far more knowledgeable about this than I am, that we could have a very interesting debate about the extent to which capital market participants pierce these various veils on the corporate balance sheet, the extent to which they figure out how to think about these liabilities, the extent to which they do the present discounted value analysis, the extent to which they understand that different items on the income statement or the balance sheet may have associated with them different probabilities of payout or different timing streams. And you know, that's complicated, but if you had to pick a starting point for the private sector, you'd say, let's go with something close to full valuation in terms of current equity values. It's more complicated than that because if the firm goes bankrupt, you do have the PBGC put option associated with the private sector, and that means that you would expect something less than full valuation if you were trying to see what was there. Okay? It conveniently, in some sense, offers, if you were doing empirical work on this topic, an explanation for why you might find less than full capitalization, and then the question would be, well, how do you think through exactly how likely the PBGC put is to be utilized and how valuable that is for the firm going forward? All right. I'm not going to try and solve that problem today, but I think the storyline is relatively straightforward. How do we contrast that for what happens in the public sector? Public sector is actually much messier, right, for a number of reasons. I mean, first, the simplest story would be it's the taxpayers, right? The taxpayers have just sort of promised, you know, someone has just on behalf of the taxpayers promised some set of current retirees, current workers, a benefit in the future and not funded it. So, at some point, the taxpayers are going to have to pay for this. But there's a question of which taxpayers, right? Because is it today's taxpayers or is it the future taxpayers? And of course, this is one of the consequences of what Josh showed us, which is that depending on how this flows through to budgetary governance, the timing of when taxes will have to be raised to cover these liabilities is very much dependent upon the way in which the state or local government chooses to work through both their own valuation of these liabilities and then to translate that into a flow of additional revenues. Note, by the way, that while many state and local governments operate under something very close to a balanced budget rule, the state pension liabilities are outside the balanced budget typically. So there's something which brings the cash flow requirement on board, but it's not necessarily something that has to be satisfied. So you can get away in some sense of doing deficit financing at the state level by fiddling with what's going on in the pension accounting. And I think that explains why there's a lot of attraction to thinking of this as part of the political system, and Josh's comments certainly set that up. Okay, what's more complicated about this in the public sector? Well, a couple of things. First, there's the fiscal federalism end. Okay, Ed's remarks about the Canadian experience certainly would translate to the U.S. context, where there are always questions about if you're local, will this become a liability of the state? If you're a state, perhaps the federal will come in and bail you out. Okay, people, you know, those of you old enough to remember the New York City fiscal crisis of 1975, the New York Daily News headline, Ford to New York City, drop dead, was basically all about the question of would the federal government come in and bail out states and localities which were under extreme fiscal duress. Okay, and even though it didn't happen in 1975 in New York City, there's always a question of if the state were big enough and the hole were big enough and the potential disruption of the capital markets was large enough, a too big to fail sort of analysis, would we in fact see some kind of bailout, right? So that's something which might take back some of the liability of the taxpayers. The other open question is, this is in some sense a negotiable liability in some states, right? In Illinois, as we've heard, it's really, really hard because this is a constitutionally protected benefit. But in some other states, it is more open to negotiation. So the other group that may end up holding the bag to some degree is the potential retirees in the future in the form of some kind of cram down of the benefit stream that might emerge in the case that the benefits were not fully funded at that point. So I think it's hard to know exactly how we think about this all playing out, but there's at least the, you know, the question of when the liability will be met and who's going to be responsible. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about capitalization effects, both in the public, in the private sector, and then the public sector, because I think it's really important for understanding how the incentives for fixing these problems play out. I mentioned that we would think that stock market would react to the unfunded DB liabilities. We see evidence that firms and management cares a lot about the way these liabilities are reported on their income statement. Right? So that to me is presumptive evidence that there are some consequences in capital markets associated with how this is done. We also know that the firms have reacted, the private sector, to changes in the environment for DB plans in the last 15 years by making dramatic changes in the nature of their coverage. Right? And I think that, you know, that sort of tells us the behavioral response that we're interested in here. This is just some data that shows you in the US the way in which defined benefit plans have essentially largely disappeared in the large corporate sector in the US. And if these were showing open plans for new employees, the evidence would be even more dramatic. In 1985, roughly 80% of large and medium establishments in the US offered defined benefit plans to their full-time workers. Recently, that number is under 30%, right? The numbers in the public sector have changed very little over the same period of time and are much higher. So today, the overwhelming majority of newly hired workers who are covered under defined benefit plans are working in the public sector. Defined contribution plans in the private sector have emerged as a bigger component at this time, over this time period. They've also expanded in the public sector, but they are in no sense displacing the DB plans in the public sector. So I think one of the questions we can ask is, well, why is that? Okay, and I think I'll tell a little vignette which my colleague Bob Merton sometimes uses as a way of kind of illustrating the challenges here. Is, you know, imagine you're the CFO, okay, and you're reporting to the CEO on the financial performance for the last year. And you start by saying, you know, we had a great year operationally. We've managed to increase sales 20%, and we've actually got $250 million of extra profit as a result. CEO says, great, and thinking about the bonus associated with that in the earnings-linked compensation package. And then the CFO says, but it turns out that interest rates also declined last year, and the equity value in the pension plan has declined. So we've actually taken a 20% increase in the discounted liability on the pension side. And when we calculate under ERISA what we're supposed to do, it means that we've actually taken a $500 million hit to the earnings statement for the DB liability. So the business was great, but we're down $250 million for the year. You can imagine the sort of, you know, unhappiness of the CEO associated with learning that something off in the balance sheet of the pension plan has just taken away the bonus that was otherwise waiting for the good performance of the operational size of the business. Okay, and as real interest rates have come down, as the volatility to the operating side of the company's earnings has been expanded from their DB plan liabilities, and as in some firms the size of the DB plan relative to the operating business has gotten larger, U.S. corporations have gotten out of the DB plan business, right, because of the extra risk and volatility. And in many cases, they've paid quite a lot to do it by essentially defeasing the liability and handing the liabilities over to insurance companies or others who will handle this. Right? So the private sector has gotten out of this game. Okay, what's happened in the public sector, and where's the analog to the shareholders or the CEOs who are thinking about this? Well, there are certainly consequences of underfunding in the public sector. Right? We know that the rating agencies for state and local debt, Moody's, S&P, follow the situation in state and local pension plans. And there's evidence that the borrowing costs are higher in states that have less fully funded plans. Right? Illinois borrows at a relatively high rate. Other underfunded plans are associated with high things. What are the analogs to the equity market capitalization effects in the private sector when we come to the public sector? It's basically something which, for a public finance economist, is the natural thing to expect, which is capitalization into land values, land prices, right? So who is responsible for those future taxes that are going to cover the pension liabilities? It's ultimately the people who own the land in the state, because two things will happen. You know, do you want to move to Illinois, knowing that the state income tax may be higher in the future to cover the currently unfunded DB liabilities of the public sector workers? Well, maybe not. And there's some recent work by J.P. Aubrey at BC again, and his colleague Caroline Crawford, suggesting that there's a very small bit of evidence that workers are less likely to move to states which have high levels of unfunded DB liabilities, but very small. Okay, probably not enough to have much of an impact on land prices. There's another question, which is, if you look across jurisdictions, do you find evidence that the prices of land in places with lots of underfunded liability, either lots of debt on the state, on the local balance sheet or state balance sheet, or lots of underfunded pension liabilities, do they tend to have lower land prices? There's remarkably little evidence on that question, and what there is pretty inconsistent. Okay? So for a number of reasons, you might think that it's hard to get that kind of capitalization story going, both because there's a question of how much information do potential migrants across state lines know about the underfunded plan liabilities? What discount rate should they use? What should they assume about those future benefit cuts? That's all a murky thing if you're trying to do the calculation. And more importantly, there may be capital market imperfections in the housing or land markets, which are different from the imperfections that plague the equity market. So if you, for example, have borrowing constraints for buying new homes, that will impede the capitalization type mechanism that I've just described. And some work by Brinkman and Cohen, Pirani and Sieg, Philadelphia at the Fed, and Penn at Pitt, all basically works out a model in which this is the case. What they show is that, amongst other things, depending on the demographic composition of a local jurisdiction, a city, for example, places with lots of older workers will be more interested in using underfunded plan liabilities. Places with lower workers who are more likely to be around over the time when they have to pay this are going to move toward higher funding ratios. And they find evidence across US cities that cities with younger populations tend to rely more on high levels of funding than cities with older populations. So a little bit of evidence that somehow the mechanics are working out here. But ultimately, this comes back to what Josh was telling us about before, because the funding decisions in the public sector have to be made by elected officials. They have to decide to raise taxes today. And there are two things to think about. First, they have a very, in many cases, a relatively short horizon till the next election cycle. And if they think that current taxes are going to decrease their probability of being reelected, that puts a very strong pressure against doing this. What about benefit cuts? The other thing to remember is public sector workers vote. And in places where there are lots of public sector workers, that provides an important impetus toward trying to keep the plans generous and not make the hard choices, which are the higher taxes today. So ultimately, I think this comes down to a really important contrast between what we see in the public sector and the private sector in the way the basic governance institutions operate to try to bring balance to these unfunded situations. And my simple narrative of what we've seen in the last 15 or 20 years is during a time when defined benefit plans became very, very expensive for their sponsors, the private sector in the US largely got out of these plans and moved to a defined contribution world, which, different panel, different day, we can discuss the adequacy of those plans as replacements. The public sector, for reasons that involve different incentives for the decision makers, has been much more reluctant to move out of that world. And I think one could also explain, as we've seen earlier on the panel, the sluggishness of the change in assumed discount rates in the public sector for many of the same reasons. So I concluded from thinking about these issues that there are many, many interesting research questions to tackle related to public sector pensions. And hopefully when we come back in a few years and think about this again, there'll be more evidence on these things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jim. So let's move to a discussion for the remaining time of the we have. So one of the things that Josh, in your own research, have shown is the underfunding situation is not only big, it's also pressing. You have calculated the duration of the average liability on public pension funds to be about 10 years. So it's not something that is out there 20, 30 years down the road. It's actually, really close. 10 years is nothing, really. So when we think about how to address the underfunding situation, it's not something that, it's a long-term problem we don't need to worry about, but something that probably is going to have huge implications in the short run. So how should we think about this? What are the remedies? What things should we be doing?
Well, I think at the city level, we're already seeing a number of cities come under pretty considerable fiscal pressure from the demands of the pension systems that have not been adequately funded in the past. Another big story of this year was the Dallas Police and Fire Fund, on which there was something equivalent to a run on the money in the fund, as it was understood that around one-third of the assets in the fund were there under a deferred retirement option program, and that those could then be removed. And so hundreds of millions of dollars have been actually removed from the Dallas Police and Fire Fund, taken as lump sum returns of contributions or as claiming of deferred retirement pensions, and that is has put tremendous pressure on the city. So I see these problems as being most immediate in cities. However, you know, another place where there as I showed in my graph, where there are very serious issues is Chicago, and the state of Illinois is also grappling with these problems themselves. So the problem is pressing, and the question is, you know, what at this point can be done? And as with most situations that are akin to fiscal or sovereign debt crises, the first kind of matter of course is to stop the increase in debt or unfunded liabilities. There are only two ways to do that. One is the what I call the start paying way, which is to start measuring pension promises under solvency-based standards and contribute, I guess what I would say would be considerably more than what is contributed now. Perhaps 100% of the solvency-based numbers would be unrealistic given the fiscal pressure cities and states are under, but something much, much more with a long-term path to basically fully funding defined benefit promises under solvency-based standards. The other alternative is the stop promising approach, which is to freeze pension promises, and I think the entire nature of the system up until now has been an unwillingness to want to do one or the other for the various political reasons that I gave. I think cities and states want to be able to have it both ways. They want to have secure promised benefits to their public employees, a number of whom presumably have entered into public service with under the understanding that they would have a secure pension benefit, but they also don't want to actually pay for the present value of those costs. And I think what we're just discovering sooner rather than later is that you can't have it both ways.
Theresa, do you have a view on that?
Well, we have our own experience with both the things you talked about. We had an insolvent plan, which we closed. Again, it was in 1977, but interestingly enough, the liabilities that were accrued under that were still paying. And essentially, the state decided to only charge the employers, so no employees are paying into that. But it's still about $6 billion, and we closed that plan in 77. So that just illustrates how challenging it is. I think another thing that you talk about, which is this run on Dallas, that really kind of hits near and dear to my heart, because if you think about how we have the hybrid plan, which is half defined benefit, half defined contribution, when the legislature created that plan, the returns on our commingled trust fund are so great because of the alternatives, because of private equity and real estate in it, that they wanted to give the defined contribution portion, the employees, access to the commingled trust fund. So our commingled trust fund is about $84 billion right now, and about $8 billion of that is in money that can be traded out of that monthly. So we spend a lot of time talking about reputation risk, and we spend a lot of time being extremely transparent about our program, educating beneficiaries, educating the legislature, and of course, having a very ethical and well-governed fund, because $8 billion could walk out the door if they lost confidence in this. And that out of an 10% of a fund, that would be a significant liquidity challenge for us.
Ed, you addressed the situation in Canada by simply doubling contributions.
Simply. So it said the contributions went up to 10%. Now, what's interesting in Canada, if you take a look at that 10%, the contribution rate that's necessary to sustain the plan, if you just start out today, is 6%.
So there is, in essence, a 4% tax that's placed on everyone between now and for the next 75 years to get the plan back to sustainability. Another way of thinking about that is if you take a look at a closed group approach to the plan right now, the closed group underfunding is close to $880 billion. So you can say it's kind of a simple change to the contribution rate, but that was a very hard choice. And I mentioned briefly in my remarks, that was a huge intergenerational transfer. You, in essence, took $880 billion from future contributions to pay for benefits that had accrued to people that didn't pay enough into the plan. So it sounds kind of simple. It's funny, when I'm listening to the talk here, I wonder how much of it has to do with the imposition of a government or a third party between the contributors and the ultimate beneficiaries. One of the things that's unique about our plan is the contributors and the beneficiaries are the same. It's, if you don't look to a third party sponsor, whether it's a corporate sponsor or a government sponsor, it goes straight down to the people that are actually the beneficiaries of the plan through an increase in the contribution rate. Now, maybe those cohorts aren't the same, as I said. Maybe there's an element of intergenerational transfer, but it is the same group of underlying people. Maybe that makes it easier. Maybe that's why we could get there.
Jim, you mentioned maybe bailouts from the federal government. Is that anything at all plausible? It seems unlikely, but.
Probably less likely today than it would have been a few months ago, depending on the outcome of the election. But I think the answer is probably not. I think it's a pretty unlikely scenario. I do think the way it could come about, and I think it's actually less likely for a single state that's in trouble than if there were broad-based capital market disruptions that led to many states being simultaneously in trouble. So if 10 states were on the ropes in many ways, it would seem less that it was the responsibility of the individual state, and the situation in which that might happen, of course, is some aggregate capital market development of, you know, a sharp decline in asset values leading to unfunded positions at a time when the states also were struggling to make their revenue needs. I mean, this is Josh's point about the circumstances, you know, the risk pricing and the state of nature analysis of when you would have trouble in these plans is very important here. But I think, you know, the notion that any individual state would receive a bailout, even if it's a big state, is much harder to see than we have a problem that is akin to a state and local, to a savings and loan problem, and we just have to deal with this because otherwise our capital markets are going to be significantly disrupted and we have to think about that. So I don't think that's a very large probability event, but I think it looms out there as something which complicates the analysis, and it might be that there are differential probabilities assessing this outcome on the part of the states and their administrators and the federal government and its elected leaders and the external analysts. And if the perceived probabilities are higher on the part of the states, that of course would lead you to underfund and hope that this will be there at the end of the day, even if it turns out not to be.
There is also, you know, going back to the short maturity of these funds and the huge numbers that we're talking about, seems hard to believe that the probability is negligible, right, of many states and many municipalities, relatively large in size, to come in simultaneously with big problems. Unless, you know, we see a huge increase in interest rates that would take care of the issue in some way, right?
Let me just start and then others can jump in. I mean, one of the features of the state-local plans is that they do have the capacity to address these issues over a modest time period, right? So the taxing authority, if you begin to ramp up, right, you can tend to cover what you currently need and slow the rate at which the bathtub is draining. And then, you know, if you're prepared to take those hard choices, there isn't a moment of truth that comes, you know, immediately when you run out of money to pay benefits, except in extreme situations. But you might be able to start to fund backwards. And this is a point that some made, you know, in the context of the most dire days of, you know, 2009, 2010 with these numbers, that really this is something where there is a bit of a margin of adjustment. You know, but if you don't make those adjustments sooner, the problem gets worse and it gets harder and harder to fix. So I think that's really important in thinking about this.
One of the common denominator in all your remarks have been the issue of governance. And Josh, you have distinguished between what's governance on the side of who decides the benefits and the contributions. And then there's the governance side of who decides how these assets get ultimately invested. And they are given contributions and payouts and inflows as a given factor to them. Jim, you have made the difference and help us to think what's the difference between when it comes to governance between public and corporate pension funds, right? And Ed, you have mentioned how you think the change in governance was key to address the issues in Canada. What should we do, or should be done, in changing governance for U.S. local and state pension plans? Are there easy remedies? Should we think about drastic changes in governance that would help to maybe address some of the issues?
Go ahead.
I'll speak at once.
I've got some thoughts. I think one of the reasons our fund is as well, it does as well as it does, is our governance structure. And one of the things that that's unique about our governance structure is we are an independent board. There's no single appointing authority that puts everyone on the board, so there's no control of the board. And then one thing that I think is unique, we definitely have, we have what's 10 voting members that represent both the plan sponsors, the beneficiaries. But we have five non-voting board members selected by the voting members, and they're investment experts. And when it was designed, the goal was, what they're concerned about is that consultants could, in a sense, way back in the 80s, could drive their agenda with staff. The beneficiary reps on the board and the plan sponsors weren't sophisticated enough to really be able to understand what was going on. So they said, let's put investment expertise right alongside the voting members. And so essentially what my voting members get is they get staff's best thinking, they get independent consultants' best thinking, and then they have the colleagues they've selected and trust who sit alongside them on the board weighing in on all of our recommendation. And so what it does is, first of all, it keeps us really on our toes, because we know someone's gonna really be looking at our work. But it also creates a very robust dialogue from three different perspectives. So I think I like a trustee board, because then they actually own the investment decisions you make. And if you think one of the biggest mistakes trustees make is overreacting to current market conditions. Because our trustees fully own and understand the decisions they've made, they're very disciplined about sticking with their strategy even when markets turn against them. And that has been a huge help for us. So I do think governance can be absolutely influential in long-run returns on the investment side.
And what specific changes would you recommend?
Well, I think, first of all, I think boards that are elected should all be completely eliminated. I think that's just a disaster. When you actually have to run a campaign to get elected to a board and you're collecting money from money managers who you're going to be allocating to, I mean, it's just flat out wrong. So I think a model similar to ours or Canada, where you guys are completely independent, you're independent from political influence. We don't actually have a policy like you, where you go to jail if you approach us about an investment. But what we do is, our audit committee, every single referral we get from an elected official or a board member, we track the disposition of it, and we report it in an open public meeting at our audit committee quarterly. So there's other ways of getting at those things, and frankly, referrals have really dropped significantly since we implemented that. So I think there's a lot of tweaks that could be made.
Yeah, I think the investment governance is absolutely important, and our system is that the board of directors has to meet a certain skill set, a certain spanning skill set, and it's focused both on functional skills as well as investment skills. And we draw across a global representation and source globally in terms of populating our board of directors, and we think that's absolutely important. But I do think the bigger problem is, Josh, is the kind of budgetary governance. I mean, we've We've talked about the underfunding. We haven't directly related the underfunding towards investment performance or because of investment performance. It's because of the budgetary governance. It's because of the lack of funding in terms of matching contributions to benefits and what that connection is and how that gets resolved. And it strikes me just listening to the three of you in terms of the American experience that that's where the real shortfall is currently. It's interesting to me, like if I take a look at our statute in terms of that budgetary governance has it codified. So I kind of referred obliquely to actuarial audits. Every 3 years our fund undergoes a sustainability test that's performed by an individual that's called the Office of the Chief Actuary, but he steps in and performs an actuarial audit of the plan. And if what he's trying to determine is the minimum contribution rate necessary to sustain the plan. Now, if that's over the statutory rate, certain things happen automatically. So there is no necessary government or political decision being made. They just happen by act of the statute. Benefits get reduced, contribution rates go up until the plan's back on a sustainable path again. So that governance, that budgetary governance is embedded straight in the document. And it strikes me that if you just leave it towards some kind of political resolution of that conflict, then you end up with all these agency problems that you've referred to. And I don't know how you reconcile those easily.
You know, one thing short of a regulatory intervention that I've given some thought to, and if there's any lawyers in the audience, you know, trust law under ERISA, you know, a trustee, it's a very high, high fiduciary standard. Our fiduciary counsel in Washington State mentioned to me one time that he thinks that essentially the plan sponsor, which in a state or a county system is the state, it's the, you know, the legislature, they're the employer, that they're violating their fiduciary duty by not funding the actuarial assumed contributions. I don't have no idea if there's any kind of legal precedent for that, but of course I'm never going to suggest that to my legislature that they're not acting in a fiduciary capacity. But I do think the law might be something to look at over time. It might even be easier than a some kind of broad government regulatory intervention.
Josh?
Related to that, I've often wondered whether, you know, is it legal for states to claim that they are running balanced budgets when the, you know, the probability that the assets will be sufficient to pay for new benefit accruals is so low. So that would be, that's another legal question. You know, in terms of governance, I mean, you know, our research confirms what you're talking about, Theresa, in terms of Washington, you know, we find that, you know, boards that are heavily influenced by politicians have poor performance in the alternative asset classes, and elected boards, very poor performance in the alternative asset classes. So there are these investment governance things that I think, you know, there are prescriptions that can be made there. But it does come back to budgetary governance, and there is a place where they intersect, which is that there are many systems out there, not yours, but those of people who are not sitting at the table, that are investing in illiquid assets for all the wrong reasons. They're investing in illiquid assets because the only way that they can justify targeted returns of 7.5% is if they have a few opaque asset categories that, when invested in by some investor out there, have generated high returns in the past. And so, you know, there are a lot of funds out there, also some ones that have fairly short duration, that are inappropriately investing in illiquid simply to justify return assumptions. And I think, you know, it comes back to the question of budgetary governance. One other question or point I want to make, or maybe raise something for discussion, is, you know, so Ed, you mentioned that there's actually a piece where benefits, you know, may, there are sort of automatic stabilizers in benefits, which makes the Canada Pension Plan not a pure formula-based defined benefit plan. And I think one of the knee-jerk reactions to unfunded pension liabilities is often to say, well, you know, everybody in the public sector should also have individual retirement accounts, which is the direction that the private sector has gone with 401ks. What about a future where there are pooled defined contribution plans, which would allow one to address the problems of individuals being 100% responsible for their own asset allocation, would also allow the possibility of good professional money management and access to illiquid assets, and would not have to go all the way to the extreme of the 401k, which has been criticized in some circles. But what are your thoughts about that?
Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I always look to Australia as a really interesting example. I mean, it's a 401k type or defined contribution system, but what they have done is they have pooled and invested in alternatives in a significant way. So, you know, they're leaders in infrastructure investing. And so one of the things that we're actually working on right now, we're doing significant research on it, is, you know, we have access in our defined contribution portion of that hybrid plan to our commingled trust fund. So now what we're trying to figure out is we also have a deferred comp 457A plan, which has significant assets in it. We're thinking, well, shoot, if deferred comp is an important component of someone's total retirement security, why don't we figure out a way to also give them access to alternatives? So, and we're looking at what Australia has done and others. And so I think, you know, even though DB is still very much preferred within my state, the hybrid was a compromise. If DC was better designed over time, I think it could be an alternative, and you would get away from some of these governance issues. But it has to be better designed than, you know, the typical 401k.
Yeah, ours is, as you mentioned, Josh, it isn't a pure defined benefit plan. We call it a kind of target benefit plan. So there are conditions under which the benefits can change going forward. So we're kind of in this halfway land. Defined benefit versus defined contribution. When the provinces are looking at that, when the federal government is looking at that and trying to ensure people's retirement savings and their capacity to stay at a certain level of replacement income in the future, I think it's really hard to get away from some kind of target benefit or defined benefit plan. It just doesn't meet the goals of the politicians in kind of putting those plans into place. But I do realize there's trade-offs involved, obviously. And, for corporations particularly, I mean, whether they should be in that business, I mean, it doesn't strike me as that's a natural place for corporations to exercise any kind of advantage, so I can understand that. But when you're taking a look at a public sector plan, I think the consequences might be a bit different.
I mean, the Dutch experience is similar to the Canadian experience, and the big problem there, and I don't know if that has been the case in Canada, is when you are in that kind of mixed regime, whether you raise contributions or you reduce benefits, that generate transfers across generations. Mm-hmm. And if you don't get that right, and it's extremely difficult to get it right, it creates a lot of dissatisfaction. In particular, you look at the Dutch experience where they might actually kill the system is because the younger generations are feeling they are overpaying. In other words, their contributions raise too much relative to how much benefits get reduced.
Yeah,
and that creates a dissatisfaction in the ultimate funders of the plan. That brings actually the funding issue to what Jim was saying. You know, you force them to hold the back, but the question now, you have two groups which are in conflict about how much of the back we should be holding each of one.
Yeah, that's so much an integral part of the discussion right now in terms of our amendments to our existing system is how do you prevent intergenerational transfers? Because especially coming out of our reforms of the late 1990s, we just said, we never want to do that again. It was just so distasteful to say that we're going to make our children pay for the benefits that accrued to us when we didn't fully pay for those. We just don't want to happen again. But how do you get around that? You know, so you talk about experience gains and experience losses, and maybe you can say you're going to amortize them over some period, but if you go straight to an ex post funding test, then you're almost back straight to the DB again, right? So you go full circle. You can say you're doing a defined contribution plan, but if you insist on a very short amortization period, you might as well say you're doing a DB plan, and you're back in the same problems.
I mean, I actually serve on ABP's investment committee, and so I've gotten to know the Dutch plans really well over the years, and one of the things that really is very challenging for them is their regulatory environment, because they do have a short time window to achieve funded status. And so, you know, intergenerational inequity goes both directions. You could actually be collecting too much currently based on a very short-term, you know, essentially a very, very low return environment and a discount rate that is essentially very low. So you've got to collect a lot now, and that's and so that's frankly, I think, killing their system. Now, again, they, you know, they they have a phenomenal system, and I don't want to be too critical of it because they are 100% funded because of that discipline they apply. But their contribution rates are very, very high based on an extremely low discount rate during a time when, you know, monetary policy has hugely influenced that. So as we go back to more normal monetary policy over time, will they look back on that and think that was a mistake as a regulator? I don't know.
Well, if you collect too much, it's politically easier to give some back than if you collect too little, and then you have to tax people in situations where there's an elastic tax base.
Right, true. But the bottom line is nobody wants to pay for that collection right now. Mm-hmm. The younger generation doesn't want to pay it.
Right, but if you think about embedding this discussion in a broader risk-sharing context, I think it's very important to distinguish the situation, as Ed started out with, where a plan is set up in a way that the original design parameters virtually guarantee that the initial participants are going to receive benefits which are much greater than their contributions, so that you start out with a major headwind, which is a liability the plan is going to accrue over time and then has to be pushed out to the future, right? So I think that, you know, most people, I believe, confronted with how would you design a system de novo, would say, let's avoid those kind of, you know, creation of unfunded liabilities. We'll then have to work off. Distinguish that from you've got a plan which is in running along, and shocks occur which hit the system. So, play out an equity market shock of the 2009 form, and play it out with an L-type return profile instead of a V in terms of the markets, and then ask the question: well, you know, how would you want to allocate the pain associated with that decline in share values across generations? In a defined contribution, a pure DC world, you have no parameters to play with, right? The answer is that those who were holding the assets at the time, if they were about to retire, it's their problem. In a simple DB world, the answer is it's all the funder's problem, right? The retirees, the beneficiaries are fully insured, and it doesn't matter what the value of the assets in the plan are doing. They're going to get what they're promised, assuming you don't have to go back and renege on the plan parameters, right? But in some sense, when you start to think about the idea of a sort of legal or pre-specified sharing rule, or something which enables you to change a retirement age or a funding level or a benefit level as a function of something which has to do with the funding levels, right? You then open up something which enables you to think about, in the public sector context, using the plan as a way of spreading the pain of an adverse shock potentially across generations. And if you come at this not as a financial economics, you know, expert, but as a public finance or a normative design government policy kind of approach, it's at least possible that you might want to say, look, you know, we had a once in a generation or once in two generation shock in capital markets or in economic productivity that takes place at some point in time. Maybe there is an argument for financing that in a way that does not put all of the pain on those who are approaching retirement at that point. It is analogous to the argument that's made, you know, your country has to fight a war, or your country has to do something like that. You know, you have an unanticipated shock that drains resources from the public sector. In the public treasury, you have this opportunity to think about the way in which you're going to distribute the cost of that over different generations. You don't have that in a private sector DC plan. You don't have that in a private sector DB plan. And this kind of embeds the question of pension funding and pension design in a much broader tapestry of how do you think about the role of the public sector in delivering social insurance. And we don't normally think about anti-poverty programs at the same time we think about the design parameters and the high levels of the, you know, the finance of public sector plans. But in some ways, some of the issues that we're facing are connected. And we should be thinking about them as somehow having, you know, relating to each other.
Yeah, just to be perfectly clear, we didn't set up the plan knowing it was going to fail. it just quickly evolved that way over there.
We did.
But I think the point is right. I mean, in any one of these plans, you're taking advantage of some kind of pooling. You know, whether it's intergenerational transfers from one generation to another, or even between men and women. Men have shorter life expectancy than women, so there is some transfer there between cohorts at some level. But it's very much, as you point out, it's a policy question, and it should be decided in a policy forum.
I agree with all of that. I do think it's very critically important to go back to thinking also about states of the world. You know, there is something problematic if the private sector is relying on similar investments as the public sector, and then is being asked in those bad states of the world to support the public fund. Then it's not clear that from a risk sharing perspective we've actually gotten it right. So I mean, I think that the framework of thinking about, you know, what's the optimal pooling and risk sharing is exactly correct, but I think the way we've implemented it raises some pretty serious questions.
Let me move to a last question. Maybe we have time for some questions from the public. So Josh, you have mentioned agency issues on how, you know, public pension funds get to invest their assets. And you mentioned this incentive maybe to go into illiquid asset classes that happen to be also risky asset classes. Jim, you have mentioned that when the ultimate funder of the plan knows its obligations, right, they internalize that and they might decide to take risk on the fund, fully knowing that, you know, they might have to make up for the shortfalls. There's always an agency issue in the corporate sector as well, which is they can go bankrupt, something that states mostly cannot. And there is a value to take risk in the pension fund because, you know, there's this put option, right? But if we think of ex ante, does it make sense in, you know, each one of you, in your view, to actually allocate part of the pension assets to risky assets, abstracting from the agency issue?
To any risky assets?
Let's make it public equities, something that is not the asset like the portfolio that will defease the liability. That we know how to do, right?
I think that is a policy question, you know, and that is the question of, it's a difficult question because it relates to the question of what is the optimal level of government debt. I mean, in effect, what public pension systems do is, you know, they're borrowing from public employees and in the sense that they're not paying them in current compensation completely, but they're paying them in deferred compensation. And then they are saying, well, what we're going to do is we're going to set aside, you know, less than the true present value of what would be needed to guarantee this benefit. We're going to invest in risky assets, which we're, you know, we target are going to pay off the benefit. Whether that is optimal from a policy standpoint depends on a lot of questions about whether, you know, is that the kind of exposure that taxpayers would like. And it also relates to what Jim brought up, however, which is the problem that people can move, they can move away. There's a question of the elasticity of the tax base, and I think that given that elasticity of the tax base, that really raises for me, you know, also combined with the state pricing problem, the question of whether this is the right way to the right model for funding public benefits. I have no kind of doctrinaire view about this, but I do believe that the public is not currently being presented with a picture of what's actually going on. Now, the way I described it is not the way that the general public typically thinks about it, which I think is an issue for making sound policy decisions.
No one wants to take that.
I would just say, I mean, I think I would be prepared to move away from the zero risky asset point for sort of two sorts of reasons. One, these are long duration investors fundamentally, and liquidity premium opportunities, as well as, you know, we don't fully understand the equity premium puzzle yet, I don't think. And to stop short of saying we'll take any of that from a standpoint where we start at zero, it seems to me it'd be worth at least taking some on. And partly the other piece is that, right, there are these opportunities because these are public plans to use the tax system to ultimately share the burden of losses. Now, I don't want to argue that we use it in an optimal way by any means, but it does provide something which enables the potential losses in the event of a shortfall to be spread over some period of time. And I think that's an important consideration in thinking about this.
Obviously, we made that decision a long time ago to move pretty far out on what people would consider the risk spectrum. So I think it's totally situational. I think it's really hard to generalize. I think it completely depends upon the governance structure and the investment organization, the skill set of the staff, the access to quality managers and the ability to find them, or the access to actually doing direct investing like Canada does. So to me, again, risk, I don't look at risk as just volatility. I mean, and again, when you think, you know, we've actually run what our actual volatility is on our alternatives to what our predicted capital market assumption volatility is, and it's hugely lower. And some of that is just because it's not marked to market daily. But a lot of it is also implementation style. So because we're trying to construct portfolios that are that have a heavy cash flow component coming through, and a lot of our return is based on those distributions and that cash, that is a much less riskier asset, frankly, than our public equity assets. Mm-hmm. Our public equity assets are actually more volatile than our private equity and way more volatile than our real estate. And then we're moving into tangible assets, agriculture, you know, those kinds of things, infrastructure. And again, those are, you know, quite low volatility, very high cash flow, and low leverage. We don't put any leverage on those. We put hardly any leverage on our real estate portfolio. So there's ways to implement alternatives that really mitigate the risk. But it takes a sophisticated, knowledgeable investor to do that.
Yeah, so let me give the kind of cop-out answer. I mentioned that we pride our arm's length status with the government very highly. And one of the corollaries of that is they're not supposed to get involved in our investing activities, and we're not supposed to comment on the policy issues. So once the decision is made to invest in risky assets, and that decision was made for us by the government officials and put in our hands, I mentioned our mandate is to maximize returns subject to undue risk of loss, having regard to the factors that affect the funding. So we're already told we got to take risk, basically, and we have to maximize our returns given that level of risk. Then the question is, Theresa said, well, how do you do that? How do you maximize returns? Do you think there's, and we've made this decision, do we think there's different drivers of asset returns? Do we think we can diversify across those more efficiently than straight bonds, straight public equities, public bonds? Yes, we think we do. We can. So how do we go about doing that? And how do we think about asset allocation? How do we think about investment selection? And how do we incorporate those factors in the construction of our portfolio? Those, I think, once you've made that public policy decision, I think you have to go down that path. I think the evidence is just overwhelming that diversification, it's a free lunch. We can talk about how much your expectation from diversification should be now as opposed to then, and what conditions have changed, and what's happened to long-term neutral, and everything else. But diversification has to come with a benefit, and it's just a question of measuring the magnitude of that benefit.
I would just observe that it seems as though all of that you've been speaking of could be achieved in a pooled defined contribution context, and that I would totally agree that, you know, the average person who's saving for retirement, who wants to have a good retirement, should be exposed to equity risk. And also, it would be desirable for them to have exposure to the possibility of excess returns that can be earned through excellent professional money management and illiquidity premia. But having vague guarantees, what is problematic is when there are vague guarantees as to who is going to make up the shortfall when that doesn't come through. And be it in a non-universal system where, you know, you have private sector citizens who are trying to do the best on their own, who are also guaranteeing the public sector, or be it in a universal system where you have intergenerational transfers, I think often these things aren't spelled out well, and it creates problems.
I'm very aware we are running out of time. Everyone needs to run to other meetings. So please allow me to join me in thanking the panelists for the session. Thank you so much.